President Trump attended the G7, which was held in Quebec, Canada. And for those of you who don't know, the G7 is very important. It's when you add a G4 to a G3. It's also when America and its closest allies come together for 2 days of meetings on economic issues. Basically, it's the world's most boring sleepover. And even before it began, things got off to a rocky start. Rocky four starts.
Before heading to the summit, President Trump sparked controversy by saying he wants Russia to be welcomed back into the G8.
We have a world to run. And in the G7, which used to be the G8, they threw Russia out. They should let Russia come back in, because we should have Russia at the negotiating table.
I don't know if Trump colluded with Russia, but if everyone was accusing me of colluding with Russia, I wouldn't be caught dead mentioning their name. Like, if your girlfriend accused you of cheating with Keisha, even if you didn't do it, just shut up about Keisha. Just shut up. Hey, babe, you know who we should invite to the party? Keisha. Nigga, I know you didn't just bring up Keisha. I know you did not just bring up Keisha. But clearly Trump doesn't know how to take a clue, because he kept bringing up Keisha all weekend long.
Some people like the idea of bringing Russia back in. This used to be the G8, not the G7. And something happened a while ago where Russia is no longer in. I think it would be an asset to have Russia back in.
The something that happened that got them kicked out of the G8 was the invasion and annexation of Crimea. Do you think that Crimea should be recognized as Russia?
Crimea was let go during the Obama administration. And, you know, Obama can say all he wants, but he allowed Russia to take Crimea.
Oh, okay, that makes sense. Russia annexing Crimea wasn't really a big deal. But we must never forgive Obama for letting them commit this atrocity, which was not a big deal at all. I mean, who even knows what a Crimea is anyway? I mean, it's just a random little place whose blood is in Obama's hands! Anyway, I think we should invite Keisha. That's what I'm saying. What does that even mean? Now, you know, for a normal G7, Trump's Russia obsession would have been more than enough drama. But for President Trump, he was just getting started.
President Trump stuns the world, pulling out of the G7's official agreement and issuing a warning to allies.
We're like the piggy bank that everybody's robbing.
This unprecedented friction with some of America's closest allies. The president, his top aides are launching this all-out assault against Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau.
The president, en route to Singapore, accused Justin Trudeau of false statements and called him very dishonest and weak.
So, Trump went into the G7 for a run-of-the-mill check-in with America's allies and then came out full-on beefing with Canada, the Ned Flanders of countries. It's safe to say that no one expected this to go this way. It's like going into the doctor for a routine checkup and then coming out as a human centipede. I don't think this is covered. I don't think it is. And other G7 leaders were shocked by Trump's actions. Emmanuel Macron called Trump incoherent, and Angela Merkel said that Trump pulling out of the deal was sobering and depressing. Although, to be fair, she is German, so everything is sobering and depressing to her. Yeah, she was probably at breakfast today like, I find this pancake man both sobering and depressing. Now, the reason President Trump went all Pusha T on Trudeau is because he claims that Trudeau was super nice to him in person, but then as soon as Trump left, Trudeau held a press conference saying that Canada still planned to retaliate against the US's new tariffs. Because you see, Trump has a policy. You don't criticize him behind his back, all right? And you also don't criticize him to his face. Side doesn't work either. Yeah, you write it down on a piece of paper and then rip it up into tiny pieces and someone will run by and pick it up. That's how it works. Because if you do criticize Trump, he'll send his guys out on TV to let you know that it's on.
The president's advisors fiercely attacking Trudeau on the Sunday shows.
He holds a press conference and he said the U.S. is insulting. He really kind of stabbed us in the back.
There's a special place in hell for any foreign leader that engages in bad faith diplomacy with President Donald J. Trump and then tries to stab him in the back on the way out the door.
Wow. There's a special place in hell for any foreign leader that engages in bad faith diplomacy with President Donald J. Trump. That is a serious threat and a very specific place in hell. That sounds VIP as shit. Yeah. That's just like one person. all the thoughts in hell are gonna be like, damn, who's that dude in VIP? But still, the question is, why on earth would Trump react in such an extreme way to a trade dispute with such a close and unthreatening ally? Well, according to Trump's economic advisor, this is all part of a greater plan.
POTUS is not gonna let a Canadian prime minister push him around, push him, POTUS, around President Trump on the eve of this. He is not going to permit any show of weakness on the trip to negotiate with North Korea, nor should he.
So this was about North Korea?
Of course it was, in large part.
Of course it was, in large part. Why was he doing that like he had just watched a Tyler Perry movie? Our president will not get pushed around. He will not. So, in essence, to win his Nobel Peace Prize with North Korea, Trump is going to start a war with Canada. It really is brilliant, and the man is playing some two-dimensional chess. Remember that photo of President Trump at the G7 summit from a few weeks ago? Remember that one where it looked like all the other world leaders were fighting with Trump because he refused to take a bath? Yeah? Well, it turns out there's a pretty sweet story behind it.
Chancellor Merkel of Germany and Prime Minister Trudeau of Canada wanted to press Trump directly to sign the communique. And Trump was sitting there with his arms crossed, clearly not liking the fact that he felt like they were ganging up on him. He said, okay, he'll sign it. And at that point, he stood up. He put his hand in his pocket and he took two Starburst candies out, threw them on the table, and said to Merkel, here, Angela, don't say I never give you anything.
I cannot believe that Donald Trump would have two uneaten Starbursts in his pocket. I also can't believe he threw them at another world leader. Although, knowing Trump, he probably immediately snatched the second Starburst back. He was like, I only meant to give you one. Yum, 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 yum. We all know that in America, many people dislike Donald Trump. But it turns out in England, they also don't like him.
Mr. Trump and the First Lady also visited Windsor Castle for his first meeting with Queen Elizabeth, which had some awkward moments.
As the visit was taking place, tens of thousands of protesters took to the streets of London carrying signs with messages like Trump not welcome and dump Trump.
The streets of London swelled with tens of thousands of people protesting President Trump, including an inflatable Trump baby blimp.
You gotta give Trump props, man. I will say, it's impressive how protests follow him everywhere, right? Do you ever think about that? Like, protests go everywhere Trump is. He's like that dirty kid from Charlie Brown. Yeah, he just carries the resistance wherever he goes. Like, at this point, I just imagine protesters even following him into the bathroom, just chanting, this is what democracy smells like! And if the British disliked Trump before he arrived, his visits only made things worse.
The president breached British protocol by publicly disclosing the details of a conversation he had with Queen Elizabeth.
He broke royal protocol by walking in front of the Queen, but she quickly stepped forward to correct the error.
He also today had tea with the Queen. He did keep her waiting for 10 minutes.
Video recorded the very punctual 92-year-old Queen checking her watch prior to the president's arrival.
Good Lord. Is there any rule he didn't break? It's like President Trump in hot water after pushing the Queen into the royal swimming pool. For more on Trump's UK visit, we're joined by an actual British person, Gina Yashere, everybody! Gina, in the US, Trump's UK visit seemed to not go so well, but as a British person, what do you think?
It was an unmitigated disaster, Trevor. This cockwomble. Yeah, that's what I called him. He came to our country and insulted us. I mean, look what he did to our queen. He's cutting her off like he's trying to beat her to the early bird special. Look, it wasn't just the protocol that he messed up. Trump was straight rude. He insulted our prime minister on tape before he even met with her. And then he blamed the mayor of London, Sadiq Khan, for terrorism. Obviously, because he's Muslim and it must have been one of his cousins.
Wow. You know, like, after this, I bet you wish that Trump had never come at all.
Are you kidding? On the contrary, I wish he'd pop by more often.
But Gina, you just said that everyone in Britain hated it.
Exactly. Everyone. The United Kingdom has never been so united. Brexit tore us apart, but Donald Trump brought us back together. I mean, before him, nobody cared about the royals. We were like, they don't work, they do nothing. Our taxes pay for them to live on posh welfare. Their downtown abbey meets shameless. But Trump walks in front of our queen, and I was like, but this is the mother of our nation, damn it! She's the jewel in our crown. Put this man in stocks and slap his balls with a wet crumpet.
Slap his balls with a wet crumpet?
Look, nobody wins here, Trevor. His balls get crushed and we waste a perfectly good crumpet.
What a historic day. North Korea and the United States meeting for the first time ever. And this is right up there with all the other great moments in diplomacy. I mean, Reagan and Gorbachev, Arafat and Rabin, Starbucks and black people. I mean, this is huge. And before we even start, we've all got to admit that we were wrong, right? We said the man couldn't do it. We said his temper would blow up the summit. But yesterday, he proved everyone wrong and turned the nuclear summit in Singapore into a huge win for himself. So let's swallow our pride and give it up for a leader who's much smarter than we thought. Kim Jong-un, everybody. Give it up for Kim Jong-un. Huh? Huh? Because, I mean, no, let's be honest, people. This dude crushed it yesterday. I know everyone's focus is going to be on Trump, but this summit belonged to little Kim. He was the bell of the ball. Think about it. The government paid, right? The government of China paid for his private plane. The government of Singapore paid for his hotel. And the president of the United States flew to meet him on his side of the world.
Earlier, before their historic sit-down in Singapore, the two leaders sizing each other up with a handshake.
Yeah, you heard that right. President Trump said meeting Kim Jong-un was his great honor. I mean, then again, when you've appeared in a McDonald's commercial talking to Grimace, everything seems like an honor. I get it. But this alone is what North Korea has been pining for decades, right? Equal standing with the American president, shaking hands, their flags side by side. Some may have seen that and thought, oh, Trump's being nice for now, but when he gets Kim alone in that negotiation room, he's gonna denuke his nuts off. But it turns out only one man lost his nuts in that room.
Trump and Kim signed a joint document committing to work towards, quote, complete denuclearization of the Korean Peninsula. The agreement is short on specifics, like whether the denuclearization will be verifiable and irreversible.
There's nothing new in this agreement. These are vague assertions from North Korea.
The piece of paper that got signed yesterday is frankly weak. I mean, this is not a strong piece of paper.
So hold up. Donald Trump flew across the world to Singapore, and all he got was Kim Jong-un saying, I'll think about giving up my nukes. That's all he got. They could have done that over text. Because you realize Kim didn't commit to anything. He basically Facebook RSVP'd a nuclear deal. That's all he did. And while Kim gave up nothing major, he got the American president to give up a lot more.
President Trump making a massive concession, agreeing to stop joint military exercises between the United States and South Korea, exercises that greatly annoyed the North Korean leader. South Korea caught off guard by the president's announcement, responding that they need to figure out the accurate meaning and intention behind the statement.
Good luck with that, South Korea. Yeah, good luck. We've been trying to figure out Trump's accurate meaning and intention since the day he stepped off that escalator. Yeah.
Like, Mexicans are rapists? Does that mean they're rapists?
But this is incredible. Kim Jong-un went up against the world's greatest negotiator, the man who literally hired someone to write the art of the deal, and got him to give up something for nothing. It's almost like Kim Jong-un did a Jedi mind trick on Trump. You know, Trump was like, yes, I will stop military exercises, and I will also pick you up from the airport. It'll be fun. Like Kim Jong-un, he owned the summit so hard. By the end, he'd even turned the leader of the free world into his personal hype man.
Kim Jong-un, as you know, has killed family members, has starved his own people. Why are you so comfortable calling him very talented?
Well, he is very talented. Anybody that takes over a situation like he did at 26 years of age and is able to run it and run it tough.
Kim is a brutal dictator. He runs a police state, forced starvation, labor camps. He's assassinated members of his own family. How do you trust a killer like that?
His country does love him. His people, you see the fervor, they have a great fervor. I think they're going to end up with a very strong country and a country which has people that they're so hardworking, so industrious.
So you saw people enslaved in labor camps and you thought, man, these people love their jobs. Really, Donald? This is what happens when you're friends with Kanye West. I mean, and now, don't get me wrong. I'm not saying President Trump shouldn't have negotiated with Kim Jong-un at all. But there's a big gap between being civil with the person and endorsing the Freddy Krueger of human rights. The only part of that summit that didn't seem to go Kim's way is when Donald Trump slipped up and appeared to make a fat joke about his new friend.
Very nice. Getting a good picture of everybody, so we look nice and handsome and thin.
Beautiful.
Perfect.
Yeah.
Look on Kim Jong-un's face. It's like a scene out of The Office. Like, he's, you can see he's thinking, make him look thin. You mean I'm not thin? Why didn't anyone tell me? Was it the death camps? Why didn't you tell me? And I guess from Trump's perspective, this is what he got out of the whole summit. Yeah, when he gets back to the White House, his people are gonna be like, Mr. President, you sold America down the river. And he'll be like, yeah, but did you see that fat joke? Worth it. If your name is Vladimir Putin, then today was a very good day. Because today, the President of the United States took your side in a fight between you and the United States.
Breaking news, siding with Putin. President Trump comes out of his meeting with the Russian president and rebukes U.S. intelligence agencies.
The president is standing with the Russian president while trashing his own country.
The President of the United States will not say he believes his own government over President Putin.
I think that press conference was the single most embarrassing performance by an American president on the world stage that I've ever seen.
Damn, the most embarrassing performance by an American president. Do you know how hard it is to achieve that? George H.W. Bush once threw up on the Japanese prime minister and Trump is now on top. And just so we're on the same page here, we're on the same page, right? When they set up this meeting last month, no one knew what it was meant to be about, right? They never knew what the meeting was for. They didn't know if it was going to be about nuclear weapons. Was it going to be about the war in Syria, missile defenses in Europe? I mean, maybe it was just going to be Trump going in to see Putin for his annual performance review. No one knew what it was. The meeting had no agenda, right? But then on Friday, Robert Mueller dropped a bombshell directly charging 12 Russian military intelligence officers with hacking Democrats during the presidential campaign in an effort to sway the election, which was major news. Like, the news was so big that it sent Cardi B into labor. She's like, Robert Mueller dropping indictments, this baby coming out now. So now, the formerly purposeless meeting between Trump and Putin had a meaning, right? It was time for Trump to put his foot down. And he did, right on America's dick.
Just now, President Putin denied having anything to do with the election interference in 2016. Every U.S. intelligence agency has concluded that Russia did. Who do you believe?
All I can do is ask the question. My people came to me, Dan Coats came to me and some others. They said they think it's Russia. I have President Putin. He just said it's not Russia. I will say this. I don't see any reason why it would be.
Really? You don't see any reason not to trust Vladimir Putin? The man was a top KGB spy. He'll steal the shirt off your back. Hell, he stole the shirt off his own back. You can't trust this man. On the list of people to never trust, Putin is right between WebMD and the mom from Get Out. How can you say this? I don't know why not to trust him because he said it. Like, now I see why Sherlock Holmes fired Trump as his assistant. Sherlock was like, well, you see, Watson, Trump, the mud on his boot contains an oxidant-rich soil found only in the small section of riverbed where the murder took place.
Yeah, but he says he didn't do it.
My God, how did you even get this job?
Electoral college.
So basically, Trump believes Vladimir Putin over his own national security team. And he didn't just let Russia off the hook for election meddling. He blamed both countries for the breakdown in their relationship.
Do you hold Russia at all accountable for anything in particular? And if so, what would you consider them that they are responsible for?
Yes, I do. I hold both countries responsible. I think that the United States has been foolish. I think we've all been foolish. We should have had this dialogue a long time ago. A long time, frankly, before I got to office. And I think we're all to blame. But I do feel that we have both made some mistakes.
Now, in Trump's defense, he has a good point. Sure, on the one hand, Russia messed with the U.S. by meddling in their elections. But on the other hand, America held elections. So they were asking for it. Yeah, it makes sense. And look, don't get me wrong. I wasn't expecting Trump to cuss out Putin to his face. But you have to admit, it's pretty wild for the President of the United States to defend Russia against the United States. It's like seeing your team's cheerleader pumping up the other side. It's like, go team! And also their team. Both teams, but mostly their team. I mean, come on, Trump. Be aggressive. Be aggressive. And once again, all of this brings up the old question of what exactly is going on between Putin and Trump. And we still don't know. Like, we may never know. But in a way, it almost doesn't matter, because you have to ask this question. If Trump was some sort of Russian Manchurian candidate, what would he have just done differently, right? Would there be a difference? I mean, in the past week, he's been tearing apart NATO. He declared the European Union America's foe. And now he's taking Russia's side on hacking America's elections. And he's slamming America's intel agencies. But it turns out there is one law enforcement organization Trump does trust. It's Russia's.
President Putin was extremely strong and powerful in his denial today. And what he did is an incredible offer. He offered to have the people working on the case come and work with their investigators with respect to the 12 people. I think that's an incredible offer.
Are you shitting me? So Putin offered to help investigate his own crime. And President out of the deal over here says, what an incredible offer. Like, how is this real life? Either Putin has something on Trump, which is why he's doing whatever he wants, or Trump is just an idiot who got played. And honestly, I don't know. Like, what did we expect? This is what you get when you put a KGB agent up against a KFC agent. The NATO summit. It's the annual meeting of the world's most powerful alliance. Sort of like if the Avengers were extremely concerned about steel tariffs. And yesterday, the meeting got off to a rocky start. President Trump had a testy exchange with the president of France. He called out Canada for not pulling its weight financially. And he demanded that Germany stop pronouncing their W's like V's.
You're making Wiener Schnitzel sound way less funny like that. It's Wiener, not Wiener.
So Trump spent all day causing chaos at the NATO summit, right? And then later that day, it led to something that nobody has seen before. A bunch of world leaders caught on camera laughing at America's president behind his back.
Breaking overnight, a video that might just drive the president crazy. It appears to show the Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau, the French President Emmanuel Macron, and British Prime Minister Boris Johnson laughing at how the president conducted himself yesterday. Watch this.
That video is amazing for two reasons. One, it is crazy that we were able to hear a private conversation between major world leaders. Like, did they not know this was happening? And two, that when world leaders get together, they are gossipy bitches just like the rest of us. I thought after meetings with Trump, world leaders would be like, okay, we need to go back and draw up a new treaty. Instead, they're out here like, what was he wearing? And the French guy's like, oh, so he can't speak English. I mean, I don't speak English, but he really can't speak English. Yeah, it turns out NATO is so catty, they should get Andy Cohen to host it. That's what they should do. And while most people thought this video of world leaders trashing Trump was hilarious, there was one person who did not find it funny.
We've got the president leading a testy NATO summit. Leaders appear to be mocking him behind the scenes, and that was the last straw. The president responding right in front of the cameras. Take a look.
Did you have a video of Prime Minister Trudeau talking about you last night?
Well, he's two-faced.
The president was scheduled to have a press conference before he left, but during that bilateral meeting, after he was asked about this video that's going viral of Trudeau that we played for you, the president said, well, I don't think I'm going to have the press conference now. I think after my bilateral meetings, I'll just get on the plane and head back home.
Yeah, in response to what happened, Trump called Trudeau two-faced and announced that he was leaving the summit early. And you know what, you know what? To be fair, Trump's not wrong. Justin Trudeau is two-faced. He's got a white one and a brown one. And as for him going home, as for Trump going home early, guys, I think they hurt his feelings. Yeah, it's like Trump was at a sleepover and all the other kids turned on him. You know, and now he's just there like, Mom, I know it's a day early, but can you come pick me up from NATO? And look, man, I know a lot of people don't like Trump, but I don't care who you are, man. Every single one of us knows this feeling. Huh? Finding out all the cool kids at school are laughing at you. And then you run home all the way crying. You know when you kid and you cry, you run with your arms dangling by your side. And for Trump, the most hurtful thing is probably the fact that Boris Johnson joined in. That's a shitty thing. That's shitty, Boris. That's a shitty move, Boris. That's your friend. You know who Boris is? Boris is that one kid you think is your real friend. And then you see him over there trying to fit in with everyone else, telling them your deepest secrets. Oh, and also, Donald told me he pees the bed. I tell you that in confidence, Boris. So shitty. So President Trump was clearly hurt by what happened. He decided to head home early. But before he left, he tried to get back at all these other dudes by making some new friends.
From the Merkel meeting, President Trump has got lunch with a select group of NATO nations, what President Trump calls the 2%ers. That's a group of 8 other nations that are spending 2% of their GDP on defense. They include Bulgaria, Greece, Britain, Estonia, Romania, Lithuania, Latvia, and Poland.
Okay, this is just embarrassing now. Trump's rolling with Romania, Lithuania, and Latvia because of what happened. It's almost like the popular kids dropped him and now he's eating lunch at the loser table. And they're probably really nice. They're like, don't be sad, Donald. You can have some of my horse tongue. It's boiled and pickled.
To get away.
So look, man, clearly NATO did not go well for Donald Trump. And I'll be honest, I don't blame the Donald for flying home early. Mr. President, you shouldn't be in a place where people are gonna laugh at you behind your back. You get on Air Force One and you fly straight back home, where we promise that we will laugh at you to your face.